And in the last class, we discussed at length on the boundary conditions for the electric and magnetic fields to be satisfied. But as the discussion was not convincing to most of you, I thought I'll discuss that for a while and then proceed further. So for those of you who are coming today, please note that we are going to discuss on boundary conditions again. So boundary conditions are essential to the understanding of electromagnetic fields from one medium to another medium. It means when the field line travels from one medium to another medium, what are the changes that are going to happen? We can learn from these boundary conditions. So here we are going to talk about the changes that are going to happen for E fields and H fields. As we are very much conversant with these things, we know that they are vectors and hence they have three components each: Ex, Ey, Ez, Hx, Hy and Hz. That is for the rectangular coordinate system. For other systems, you will have similarly three components for electric field and three components for magnetic field strength also. So if you want to identify what changes are likely to occur when the field line travels from one medium having dielectric constant of epsilon 1 to another medium of dielectric constant epsilon 2, you are all aware that there is definitely going to be some change. Now our interest is to represent the change as Ex2, how it is related to the electric field component in the first medium, that is Ex1. Similarly, what is the relation of Ey2 with the Ey1? So we can work out using our standard methods or the earlier rules and regulations. But what is the problem we are going to find ultimately is, suppose we decide that some Ey2 is equal to some K1 times Ey1. Ex2 is equal to some K times Ex1 like this. Then when we send this information, people on the other side of the globe may consider that what is this Ex? Where exactly is this? Should it be taken in specific direction only? So all these doubts will be coming up into the minds of others. But mind you, as I told earlier many times, engineer's language must give unambiguous ideas. There should not be any confusion in the minds of the people when a statement is given by an engineer. So we are now ready to choose the words and other things so that it gives the same meaning to anybody on the globe. So in that sense, we don't want to talk in terms of X, Y and Z components, because people can choose these X, Y and Z coordinates in any way they like as long as they follow a right-handed system. So what is Y for me may be X for you people and Z for somebody else in another country. So this way, when we give the equations of Ey2 is equal to some K1 times Ey1, Ex2 is equal to some K times Ex1 like this, is to be avoided. Then what is the way we can suggest these things? Then instead of saying in terms of X, Y and Z, we are now trying to choose with reference to the interface between the two media. So the plane that is separating the two media under consideration, with epsilon 1 on one side and epsilon 2 on the other side as the dielectric constants, we are now going to take with reference to the medium, that is, one is the tangential component and the other one is the normal component. So tangential component means if this is the plane which is separating the two media, this parallel to this plane, either this way or this way, can be considered as tangential component. This direction perpendicular to the surface is considered as the normal component. So you can choose your X, Y and Z according to this. And tangential component, when we are talking of, it can represent say x and y, whereas the normal component can represent the z component. So tangential and normal are more convenient ways of informing the changes instead of ex2, ex1, ey2, ey1 and other things. That's the first thing. So tangential, when we are talking of, it basically represents two components. One is either x and y or y and z or the other way. But definitely you are going to be very, very unambiguous when we know the details in terms of tangential and normal components. Please remember, this is the one which we all must also practice in our day-to-day activities. Informing others in an unambiguous manner is an important thing all of us must continue to practice. Then, what about the tangential component? Yes, tangential component of E and normal component of E will be there. So across the boundary, one of them is going to change. Otherwise, you will not have any change of E from one medium to another medium, which we cannot accept by simple logic. So either tangential E is going to change or normal component of E is going to change. Similarly, when we consider the flux density or the displacement current, the tangential component of D, displacement, either it's going to change or the normal component of D is going to change. So we are now having four parameters for concerned with electric field. Similarly, four parameters will be coming up for magnetic field also. Out of these things, four components will be changing, four components will not be changing out of eight. What are the eight? E tan, E normal, D tan, D normal. Four, similarly four for magnetic field strength also. So out of these eight, only four components will be changing across the boundary. Four components will not be changing across the boundary. So what is informed by these textbooks are that the components which are not changing across the boundary, the components are E, D, H and V. The components are E, D, H and V, which are not changing across the boundary, are only clearly mentioned. Not changing across the boundary is put in a very short form as continuous. Continuous means the variable is not going to have any change across the boundary. So E tangential is one of those things that is not changing. Why it is not changing, we'll see in the next slide. See here, whatever I mentioned just a while ago, all these things are included in this. So see here that the tangential components are shown in this, normal component are shown in this, tangential component of H are shown in this, normal component of B are shown in this. Why are we taking tangential for E and normal for D or the other way is to see that the information given is very, very unambiguous. To see that the information exchanged is very, very unambiguous. So here you can see ET1 and ET2, okay, across the boundary. Then this is the way we try to represent the next one. So please remember, this ET2 and ET1, when we consider a closed box around this, Okay, and if the box is having a length of say delta y and a height of delta x, then if you start from this point et1 into delta y, okay, plus e normal into delta x minus et2 into delta y plus e m into delta x must be zero around the closed path. I am starting from here, going up to this, taking the voltage. How do I calculate the voltage? Et1 into some length, say delta y. Then again, I am calculating across this, right? Delta x plus I am going in the reverse direction of the field. So again, there is a negative sign. Et2 into delta y, and again into delta x. The field into delta x. So everything is. Potential we are trying to calculate. Potential around a closed path must be equal to zero. So when we take et1 into delta y minus et2 into delta x, as both are very very close, but they are zeros, and as delta x tends to zero, this et1 must be equal to et2. That means tangential component of electric field across the boundary must be same. Whatever value it has on the one side of the boundary, it will have the same value on the other side of the boundary also, right? So it is given in a very short form as tangential component of E is continuous across a dielectric interface. Across a dielectric interface. How do I know that it's a dielectric? It has epsilon 1 mu 1 on one side, epsilon 2 and mu 2 on the other side. No conductivity term is included, means they don't have any conducting nature. Obviously, they are both are dielectric media. Is it fine? So when we talk of tangential component of E like this, right? But now I am not choosing normal component of E. Please remember, what I am choosing is normal component of D, not E. Why am I choosing like this? Because I am going to see that it is again calculated using Gauss law. That means what is the total flux coming in and what is the total flux going out. Total flux is calculated as flux density multiplied by surface area. So I am taking a surface of dA at delta S, no problem. And dN1 into delta S is the flux coming in, dN2 into delta S, that's flux going out. As there is no storage of flux or storage of charge across the boundary, so dN1 into delta S must be equal to dN2 into delta S. That means dN1 must be equal to dN2. Normal component of flux density must be same. Okay, I have not chosen tangential component of D displacement. Very carefully, I have chosen normal component. Okay, that means for one vector, I am choosing the tangential component. For another vector, I am conveniently choosing the normal component. Means, what happens to the normal component of E across the boundary? Can I get it? What happens to normal component of E? That has to change. How do I represent that change? That can be inferred from a knowledge of this. En2 is equal to something of En1. En2 is equal to something of En1 can be obtained from this information. How? Instead of dN1, you please substitute as epsilon 1 into En1. Instead of dN2, epsilon 2 into En2. So you have En2 on one side, En1 on the other side, which is related by a ratio. What ratio? Epsilon 1 by epsilon 2. That means as we are talking of tangential component here, what that is not changing, and the normal component change can be expressed as the medium to electric field normal component is related to medium one electric field component by the ratio of dielectric constants. That word ratio gives lot of confusion, because it can be taken by some people as epsilon 1 by epsilon 2, by some other people as epsilon 2 by epsilon 1. So as the word ratio gives a confusion or a chance of giving wrong information to many people, we are avoiding using the word for representation of electric field normal components, and we are not going to talk anything about that. The one which is not changing across the boundary, we are clearly mentioning by that. If one is very confident about this, okay, one can deduce what is the relation of electric field normal component in the second medium and what is its relation with the electric field normal component in the first medium. Am I clear? That's the beauty in this boundary condition. That means the variables which are not changing are clearly mentioned. The variables which are changing across the boundary can be deduced very conveniently with this information without any ambiguity. Is it clear? So similarly, you may ask me, how about the tangential component of B, displacement density? Across the boundary, what's going to happen? Normal component is not changing. Obviously, tangential component will have some change. What is the change that's going to come? That can be deduced from a knowledge of the tangential components of the electric field. So this ET2 is equal to ET1 is what we have derived earlier. So this this ET2 electric field is replaced by DT2 displacement by epsilon 2. This E is replaced by D1 by epsilon 1. Then you can get the tangential component of displacement density in the second medium is related again with ratio of epsilon 1 to epsilon 2 and tangential component of displacement density. So again, that word ratio here comes out as epsilon 2 by epsilon 1. Whereas in the earlier case, normal components of electric field, it has come out as epsilon 1 by epsilon 2. So that confusion is avoided by mentioning the components which are continuous across the boundary. The tangential component of E is continuous. The normal component of displacement density is continuous across the boundary. So taking these two continuous conditions, you can deduce the ones which are changing across the boundary without any ambiguity. Am I clear? So similarly, we can also work out for the magnetic field components. Again, the magnetic field components case also comes on the similar lines, that HT2 tangential component of magnetic field is continuous across the boundary, because you are going to follow HT2 into some delta y multiplied plus H into delta x minus HT1 into delta y plus H into delta x, and as these are the bitwise components are going in the opposite direction, it should go to, they should cancel out each other, and the lengths are same, so HT2 must be equal to HT1. Tangential component of H is continuous across the boundary. Similarly, normal component of flux density, magnetic flux density, is continuous across the boundary, because net flux coming in and net flux coming out must be equal, because flux lines are continuous or circular loops. So you can again see that a similar argument, whatever we have done here, holds good here also. So that's the boundary condition. So by knowing the field quantities which are not changing across the boundary, we are able to deduce the field quantities which are having some change, particularly ratio. The word ratio is giving ambiguity, epsilon 1 by epsilon 2 or epsilon 2 by epsilon 1. Similarly, mu 2 by mu 1 or mu 1 by mu 2, which way it has to go is avoided by mentioning these two conditions. So this is the simplest case of interface between two dielectrics. Okay, and if there is any other type of materials, that means one side you have dielectric and the other side if you have a conductor, dielectric to conductor interface when you have, then you are going to have the charges coming up across the interface. Why the charges are going to come? Because the field cannot proceed further. The electric field, once it is incident from the dielectric medium onto the conductor on the other side, it cannot proceed further. So once it cannot proceed further, the electric field lines get terminated. And once the electric fields are terminated, then you will have a charge induced on the body. Similarly, magnetic flux lines also cannot proceed any more further, so they create the current. Right? So this is the change what we are going to have if the interface is between dielectric and the conductor. Okay? So this is what we have been discussing earlier, and this is how the equation is to be formed. And you will have, if there is any surface current, magnetic surface current possible across the boundary, then you are going to have the change in the magnetic field by the surface current as shown here. Okay, so here you have incoming magnetic flux lines and outgoing magnetic flux lines. If there is any difference in the values of those things, the difference must be equal to the surface current present. Okay, so that's what we are finding here. Similarly, incoming electric flux lines and outgoing electric flux lines, if there is any change, then that should be equal to the current in this manner. This is magnetic current, this is electric current density. Magnetic current density and this is electric current density, what we have in this case. Okay, so boundary conditions are not to be confused with what is this, why are we talking about only one at a time, why not both the components of the same quantity. Both the components of the same quantity will not be continuous. Electric field tangential as well as electric field normal will not be continuous. So the change is definitely there. The change is not mentioned directly, it is given in an indirect manner. That's the speciality here. So as you can see here, the fields at the interface with a perfect conductor, fields at the interface with a perfect conductor, you are going to have like this. Okay, the fields will get terminated, or the flux lines get terminated, and the number of flux lines coming up and the charge that is developed will have a balance in terms of Gauss law. And the magnetic field lines, when they get terminated on that, you will have the current coming up on this. This is the basic principle on which all your receiving antennas are working. Whether your mobile phone or laptop or a tab or wireless phone or whatever, any other antenna system, if you are using it, the receiving antenna works on this principle that N cross H is equal to Js. What does it mean? The magnetic field and the current induced, the magnetic field direct, incoming magnetic field direction and the current induced on the surface of the conductor follow a right-handed system. They are perpendicular to each other and both of them are again perpendicular to the normal to the surface. Normal to the surface, incoming magnetic field and the generated current, they follow a right-handed system. Normal to the metallic conductor, incoming magnetic field strength and the current induced, that the direction of the current induced on the conductor, they follow a right-handed system. So as the incoming electric field is going to be parallel with this, because incoming electric field also follows the same right-handed system. Incoming electric field, incoming magnetic field, and incoming power. These three follow a right-handed system, and hence the conductor is placed in general parallel to the incoming electric field strength. That's what we mean by polarization. Okay, we are going to discuss some more things on this. So this equation is the most crucial for all your wireless systems. Receiving antennas follow this particular equation all the time. Okay, so please remember this carefully. And across the magnetic wall boundary, this is what is going to be the future. Please remember these equations, people were not careful earlier, but now in future you are all going to work with these equations. Why we are talking about this? So far people are using only electric conductors or conducting materials as antennas, maybe made of iron, steel, or copper, aluminium, brass, etc. So as these ones are considered to be highly diamagnetic, there is no magnetic current present in all those things, even though there is some incident electric field, and hence this M cross E is conveniently taken as zero for them. But now, as you can see, most of the cars are becoming more or less lot of electronics, and a good amount of wireless things are going to be present for the safety of operation of the cars and other devices. High frequency circuits are being used. Circuits operating beyond 30 gigahertz, 60 gigahertz, or even 90 gigahertz are being used inside the cars. And similarly, you are also observing that a lot of our household devices are going for IoT enabled. Your refrigerators, rice cookers, air conditioners, geysers, all these things are now going towards the IoT enabled, or 5G communication they are trying to use, and many other things. All these things work at very, very high frequencies, like more than 30 gigahertz. So there, the materials used for the wireless systems, okay, is not going to be again metallic. A lot of dielectrics are being considered, and the system is directly incorporated or fabricated on a single material. That means all the electronics and the antenna associated with that is also going to be fabricated on the same chip, so that the size of the IoT enabled device is very, very small. Okay, so in those cases the materials used are no longer going to be metals, they are going to be highly magnetic materials. Okay, paramagnetic, not necessarily ferromagnetic, but definitely paramagnetic materials are going to be used, and hence this equation takes more importance in those cases. Okay, you are going to have magnetic current density coming up, okay, and which is related to the incoming electric field by this. In this case, the incoming electric field, the normal to the surface, and the induced magnetic current density are going to be following a right-handed system. Okay, N, E, and M, they follow a right-handed system. Okay, so what are the units of this quantity, magnetic current density, by the way? As you can see on the left hand side, the units of E, we know that they are volts per meter. That means this magnetic current density must also have the units as volts per meter. What's the name we are talking of, and observe what are the units we are having with this. The name given is magnetic current density, it's a current, but what are the units? Volts per meter. Okay, so it's like a current having units as volts. What current it is? We call it as magnetic current. Okay, so magnetic current has the units of volts. So here we are taking magnetic current density, so it will be volts per meter. So please remember this special things are coming up in future and changes are likely to happen in the discussions of electromagnetic theory also in this context. So this IoT, 5G communications and all these things are forcing the electromagnetics people to come out with the new theory in these aspects. Okay, a lot of magnetic materials are being considered for many other communication equipment and okay, radar and electronic warfare systems also. So magnetic materials are gaining popularity, and in all those cases, the starting point for calculations will be this sort of an equation. Okay, so that's the practical importance of this equation. And now let us see what are the next steps for this. Okay, this equation is the most familiar one. This is the most familiar one which we have been using for a long time, because we are talking of perfect conductors. All our normal conductors are considered as perfect conductors, like copper, aluminium, brass, iron, etc., because they have very, very high conductivity, more or less. And this is the equation we have been using so far. Okay, but I told you the equation which we are going to use in future is going to be slightly different. Okay, this is the equation people are going to use in future, particularly with magnetic materials. Okay, high dielectric constant materials. Okay, and induced with some cobalt, iron, nickel, etc., to a certain extent, like ceramic type of materials are going to be used. And this is how the thing, the whole electronics as well as the antenna and everything will be printed on the same material. Okay, even silicon can also be used for that case, and here you will have a semiconductor nature for that. That means partially like this and partially the other equations you have to work with it. So these are all the changes which are having good research opportunities for many of you who want to pursue in that area. Okay, so now let us see what are the issues we have with these Maxwell's equations. Maxwell's equations are very convenient to start and work out. Okay, because we have a simple linear equations of first order differential equations, del cross E is equal to minus dou V by dou T. On one side you have space differentiation, del means dou dou X, dou dou Y and dou dou Z. And on the right hand side you have a time differential. Space differentials are related to time differentials. So how on space and time coordinates are related? X is equal to Vt, we know. That means there will be something that will be coming which is related to velocity as you form these equations exactly. Okay, so del cross E is minus dou B by dou T, del cross H is equal to J plus dou D by dou T, like this. So the first equation when you take into account, del cross E is equal to minus dou B by dou T, or del cross E is equal to minus mu times dou H by dou T. E is there on the left hand side, H is there on the right hand side. Two unknowns. That means if you have two unknowns, how many equations we need? Please, can you answer me? How many equations we need to solve two unknowns? How many equations are required to solve two unknowns? How many equations are required to solve two unknowns? How many? 1? 5? 2.6? Okay, yeah, it's two equations that are required to solve. That means you have to solve two simultaneous equations. On one side you have E, and on other side you have H. Okay, but this E and H are not scalar quantities, they are vector quantities. That means Ex, Ey and Ez, Hx, Hy and Hz. That means six unknowns are there for us to solve any electromagnetics problem. Six unknowns means obviously you need six equations. So when you expand del cross E, you will have some number of equations. Again, the del cross H is equal to J plus epsilon times dou E by dou T. Again, E is coming up, H is coming up on that. So again, you will have some more equations. So six equations you have to form and you have to solve all six equations simultaneously. That was the problem people faced in 50, 60 years ago when they were working very hard with electromagnetics. Okay. So six equations, is it good for us when we don't have any computers, any programming, no calculators or any other things? When the help was very, very poor on these things, people wanted to have a single equation with one unknown. Okay, please see the proceeding of this. One equation people wanted to have with one unknown. Okay, and like that, I don't mind having six equations with six individual unknowns in each of them. Ex, y is one equation, ey, y is one equation, like that. Okay, but ideally, I can think of one equation which can be used to solve all six components. That's the most wanted situation. That means if I solve for one component by interchanging the symbols here and there, I must be able to get the second component, third component, fourth, fifth, and sixth. That means I solve only one equation, I want to get all six components. That's the most wanted. See the engineering approach in these things. Okay, so how do we proceed for this? What is the challenge? Instead of solving six simultaneous equations to get six components, okay, people wanted to have only one equation, and with that equation itself, I want to get all six components. See, does it appear to be an interesting one or not? Definitely interesting, definitely challenging. What has been done for that? Okay, what has been done to avoid solving six equations to get six components? Just solve one equation to get all six components. That's the beauty of the electromagnetics here, what you can think of. Okay, so what is to be done? Ultimately, I want to get one equation with one unknown. That means in the Maxwell's equation, I wanted to see that on left hand side there is electric field component and right hand side also there is electric field component. That's what I would like to bring in, instead of electric field on left hand side and magnetic field on the right hand side. So what is to be done for that and how do we proceed? Let us try to see. Just 1 minute. Okay, I'll just come with another one for you. In this, okay, just 1 minute. Hold. Let the first equation be simplified as del cross E is equal to minus mu times dou H by dou T. Del cross E is equal to minus mu times dou H by dou T, as H is supposed to have time variation as e power plus j omega T. So first differential is going to give me e power minus j omega mu times H. This H bar indicates that it is taken with only space variations. The H is normally having space variations as well as time variations, but the time variation is considered as simply e power plus j omega t. So excluding the time variation, all other variations still present in this to reduce the complexity in this. Similarly, as we are considering source free region without any electric current or charge or anything, we are assuming that the fields are existing at this time and the medium is simply linear, isotropic and homogeneous, and thereby del cross H is having J component 0 and dou D by dou T is again represented as epsilon dou E by dou T. E is also considered to have time variation as e power plus j omega t. That means E is having XYZ variation as it is. The time variation is simplified. So differential with the time E is going to give you the same thing again, j omega epsilon times E like this. So now you can see that we have two first order differential equations and E and H components exist on both sides. Please remember, these are not two simple equations. They are actually decomposed into six equations. Why six? Ex, Ey, Ez, Hx, Hy and Hz. But what I want ultimately is one equation with one unknown, which should be satisfying for X or Y or Z, either for E or for H. See, what is the challenge? Instead of six equations, I want to bring it into one equation. That's how, what we are trying to say is, if you want to decouple them, that's what mathematically they say, means both E and H existing in both sides should be avoided. Only E must be present in the entire equation or H must be present in the entire equation. I want to make them like that. So to get removed off H from this first equation, what I am trying to say is that H, if I want to remove, H is equal to something. But what I have in the second equation for me is del cross H. So if you want to bring in this del cross component onto this, what is suggested is that you take del cross operation on both sides so that del cross H appears on the right hand side of the first equation. So del cross E is going to be equal to minus j omega mu times del cross H. Okay, so this del cross H on the right hand side is going to be replaced with something of E on this side. So del cross E is related to again E like this. Okay, omega square mu epsilon times E. Omega square mu epsilon times E on this side. So left hand side, space differential two times. Space differential two times, del cross and again del cross. Each del is a space differential, dodo x, dodo y, dodo z. And what is the right hand side? Simply E is there. So E is related to E, which is considered as a simplified thing. What is the penalty? Can you tell me what is the complexity we have included in this process? As you can see, this del cross E can be expanded, which is a standard mathematical form as del of del dot E minus del square E. Del of del dot E minus del square E is the expansion for this, is equal to omega square mu epsilon times E. Now, this del dot E is definitely zero. Why? Because there are no accumulated charges. Del dot D, the Gauss law says that there are no charges present. If del dot D is equal to zero, del dot E is also equal to zero because they are related simply by epsilon. So this del first term goes to zero. Second term is what we are having now. So del square E plus omega square mu epsilon E is equal to zero is the now equation what we are going to solve. What is this equation? Everything is in terms of electric field strength. This equation is the representative or the modified form of the first two Maxwell's equations as we know of. That means if you solve this equation, you are basically solving the first two Maxwell's equations. So physical realizability is guaranteed by this. But what is the penalty what we are going to have? Can anybody suggest? Okay, we are getting a lot of advantage, but what is that disadvantage point? What is the difficulty we are now accepting in doing this? Remember, the Maxwell's equations are first order differential equations. Dodo x, dodo y, dodo z type of things are only present. Whereas, if you are trying to solve this, you have second order differential equation. Dou square E by dou x square, dou square E by dou y square, dou square z.
dou square E by dou Z square will be the type of equation what you are going to have. Second order differential equation is the penalty what we are going to accept instead of first order differential equation. But with first order differential equation, if you want to proceed, what is the difficulty? You have to solve 6 equations. What is the advantage with this second order differential equation? This second order differential equation is valid for all the 3 components of E. Ex, you can put here Ex, Ex, or Ey, Ey, Ez, Ez. It is valid for any of the electric field components. Similarly, just replacing by E with H, you get a similar equation in terms of H also. And again, this H equation is valid for Hx, Hy and Hz components. That means one single equation can give you answer for all the 6 components. That's the beauty in this equation. That's the beauty in this equation, which can be used for solving any of the 6 components you are interested in. That's what the engineering is. With very little amount of work, we can get huge amount of advantage. Okay, so please remember, this equation is not given to indicate that these are waves and wave equation and all these things. This is given out of our necessity to avoid solving 6 simultaneous equations without any computer help or programming like MATLAB or C++ or something else. You can now directly attempt to solve this equation, because second order differential of space variables, second order differential with time variables, you can relate them very easily by choosing a simple sine function or a cos function, because second differential comes to the same thing again. Sine second differential is just minus sine. Cos second differential is again just with minus. So this basically represents something similar to your simple harmonic motion, where we are very, very comfortable and so many things we know about it. That's why this equation is very much useful for us. This has been proposed by Helmholtz after the name of the scientist. So this equation is known as Helmholtz equation. Okay, that second order differential is related to the same function itself. Simple harmonic motion also, displacement is related to the acceleration, second differential of displacement. Displacement is related to acceleration. That's how you say simple harmonic motion is coming up. Okay, A must be something of minus kx. So here also, second differential is related to minus of something of E. Is it not? So what is that something is? That something is taken as k square in general. R k is given as omega root mu epsilon. Okay, so this is the speciality in this. Okay, so this equation is the way we are going to work with. Why we prefer always Helmholtz equation is this. But mind you, the present day software tools are coming up to solve these equations simultaneously. To solve these equations simultaneously for all 6 equations we take and try to proceed, so because we have good amount of computing power these days and a lot of programming skills are available now, and hence people are trying to solve electromagnetics problems with software tools using these 2 equations. But if you want to use your conventional analytic methods, this is the one which is being followed. Okay, so this equation is also known as wave equation. Why it is wave equation and what is what, we shall see now. Okay, so far okay. What is the advantage? These 4 equations are really useful for people who want to go for innovation or something creative they want to bring in. First, understand the challenges, go for the situation and how people have solved in the earlier days, try to understand the clues. Then if you apply those ones for present day problems, definitely you can also come out with solutions for present day things. So please, in that context, for those who want to go for new items or new components, new systems, new theory, new protocols, please try to understand this. If you want to solve the basic Maxwell's equations to to get the components of electric field and magnetic field, you have to solve 6 simultaneous equations without the help of computers and programming and all those aspects. Instead of solving 6 simultaneous equations of first order type, dou Ex to dou X or dou Ex to dou Z, dou Ey to dou X, like this, this sort of 6 components are avoided by merging them into a simple equation where one unknown is present. That equation can be used to get all the 6 components simultaneously by substituting that it is X here, or Y, or Z, like this. That's the speciality of one equation which can be used to solve all 6 components. How are we getting it? By taking curl of the first equation on both sides. Del cross is applied on both sides and del cross H is replaced with the second equation as this. So del of del dot E minus del square E is the expansion for del cross E, and here the left right hand side remains the same. Del dot E becomes 0 because we are considering source free region. Del dot D is equal to the source. If there is no source, del dot D is 0, and hence del dot E is also 0. That's what we are trying to write, and hence del square E plus omega square mu epsilon is equal to 0 is the equation what we are going to have with this. Okay, now let us try to understand some more details of this. Why is it called a wave equation? As you can see here, this del square E, okay, for a first order case, let us take that this del square represents only one variation, okay, and this variation what we are considering is along Z, and what component of E we are considering? Just simply X component is considered. X component of E is considered, and it is having variation along Z direction only. So dou square Ex to dou Z square plus K square Ex is equal to 0. So now this equation is very, very comfortable for us to solve. So Ex component, which is varying along Z, is going to have sinusoidal variations because second differential must be same as the original with a minus sign. So dou square Ex to dou Z square is equal to minus K square Ex. So Ex must be this. Okay, so instead of X, you can put Y or Z or H, whatever way you want, and you can increase the variations possible. What we have taken here is only Z variation. You can also consider X variation and Y variation, etc., which we are going to do in future classes. Okay, and thereby this is what the case is. Now let us try to see that this Ex of Z is assumed to have e power j omega t type of variation. So in the time domain, if you are going to put, you can see that this can be represented with the cos omega t, sin omega t type of variations as well. So this Ex, though we say it is Z, it is not actually only Z, it is also having time variation built in. E power j omega t is built in. Why e power j omega t is built in? Because k square is defined as omega square mu epsilon. That omega indicates what is the time, the frequency with which this E is varying with this. Okay, that means this is having some relation with the time variation, and this is having some relation with the distance variation. So distance variations and time variations are related by this. So obviously something in between that comes is the velocity. So what is that the velocity of this wave is? How do I know the velocity? What is the dz by dt? The dz by dt, when I want to take from this, what is that that's going to happen? Let us try to understand. So d dt of with the displacement. What is the displacement we are going to have? It is going to give you omega t minus constant by k, or omega by k, or simply it is equal to 1 by root mu epsilon, means this is going to have a velocity. When it is traveling at a velocity of 1 by root mu epsilon. If you substitute this mu and epsilon for the free space case, we find that it travels with a velocity of this one, 2.998 × 10⁸ meters per second. Okay, that's why it actually represents a wave. Why does it represent a wave? Is that if a disturbance is found to have regular variations in space, regular variations in time, then that disturbance is known to be called as a wave. A disturbance which is going to have regular variations. How can I say it's regular variations? Please remember, if there is no time variation factor for this, dou square Ex2 dou Z square is equal to 0. Second differential must be 0. So first differential must be some constant, and the original function must be AT plus B type of thing. AZ plus B type of thing. Is that not? So it must be having some regular variations for that. Similarly, if displacement variation is 0, only time variation exists, it is also possible to have. So this is what the case is. It is again giving you that k square Ex can be also 0 in certain cases, or dou square Ex to dou Z square can be 0 for certain other cases. So these two things indicate that this Ex is varying in space at regular in manner, that is in a sinusoidal form. That means at certain positions it has very high value, at certain positions it has zero value, at certain positions again it has high values. The separation between two successive high values, okay, is going to be same at various locations. The separation distance is known as the wavelength. The separation distance between two successive peak values or two successive low values is going to be called as wavelength. Similarly, at a single location, if you observe, it is going to have same variation with reference to time. And again, these variations are going to be repetitive. The repetitiveness in time, if you observe, it is going to be fixed. That fixed time of repetitiveness is known as time period. So with reference to time, it is going to change. With reference to distance, it is going to change. And both are having regular variations. These two are very specific. The space variation's regularity is indicated by wavelength. Time variation regularity is indicated by time period. Wavelength is measured in meters. Time period is measured in seconds. The relationship between them is again through velocity. Okay, so the velocity is coming up in this manner. You can also check the units of these things. The mu has the units of henries per meter. The epsilon has the units of farads per meter. Henries into farads will give you seconds square. So square root of that is seconds. And per meter under the root is going to give you the numerator as meters. So the units will be meters per second. Okay. How the farads into henry is giving you the units as second square? Please check. Farads is coming from charge per unit voltage, coulombs per volt. And this henry is coming from magnetic flux per unit current. The magnetic flux is given the units as volt seconds. Volt seconds per ampere, and epsilon is given for coulombs per unit voltage per meter. And taking these things together, you will get that units as second square. Mu epsilon has the units as second square. So that way you can see these things. So the velocity with which this wave is going to travel is given by this. As this equation is representing situation similar to a wave, this equation is known as wave equation. We are not interested in waves and wave equations and other things. First of all, we are interested to get E component. Only one component I want to find instead of all six. I want to have one equation with one unknown. That's what I started with Maxwell's equations, worked out in a very intelligent manner and got single equation. That equation incidentally gave me the nature of a wave, and hence it is known as a wave equation. Please remember, we are not interested to get wave equations. We are interested to get one equation to solve all the six E and H components, and that equation is incidentally represented that of a wave, and hence we call it as wave equation. To be more precise, the credit should be given to Helmholtz, and thereby more appropriate to call it as Helmholtz equation. Okay, so for the purpose of students, Helmholtz equation or wave equation mean the same thing. Okay, it is a way by engineers to avoid solving six equations by solving a single equation with a single unknown. The wave equation can be used to get any of the six components, Ex, Ey, Ez, Hx, Hy and Hz. Please remember, for discussion's sake, we have taken this as Cartesian coordinate system of X, Y and Z. But the wave equation is valid for cylindrical coordinate system as well as space coordinate system. Okay, so that means you can replace this Ex, Ey, Ez with E rho, E phi and Ez, or Er, E theta and E phi components. It is equally valid for all these things. Okay, so this is about the wave equation and its importance, and the velocity here we call it as phase velocity, because the phase of the wave, how it is traveling, is only represented by this. This dz by dt, what we are taking up, represents actually the phase velocity, phase with which it is traveling. Okay, so omega by k is the value by which we are getting this. So this equation is for plane waves in a lossless medium. How can we say it is a lossless medium? It is indicated by this value of k. The k is coming out to be simply omega square mu epsilon, but in other cases it's going to have some other components also, and thereby the wave is going to be having some attenuation also in this case. As I told you just a while ago, this wavelength is defined as the distance between two successive maximum values. Maximum is singular, maxima is plural. Please remember that is, so two successive maxima values, if you take, the distance between them is called as lambda, or wavelength, which is represented as meters. Okay, and now on the same lines you can also see the magnetic field can also be found, and the relation between E vector and H vector is given in this manner. E by H is going to give you a simple constant called eta, wave impedance eta. Okay, wave impedance is having the units of ohms. Wave impedance is given as root mu by epsilon. Velocity is given as 1 by root mu epsilon. So if you know the medium parameters mu and epsilon, you can find what will be the velocity with which the waves can travel with this. What is the impedance the waves undergo when they travel through that particular medium? The eta is given as this. So this is what the simple way of understanding these wave behaviors and other things in this subject. Okay, now coming to the word like plane waves, right? What is that the plane wave means? Okay, when electric field is progressing, the phase of the electric field is going to change at various locations. Okay, so for different rays of this waves, if you join the equal phase response points, equal phase values points of these waves, if you join, that surface is known as wavefront. The surface joining equal phase points of different rays, that is known as a wavefront. And if the wavefront is coming out to be a plane, when does it come? If any two points on the surface, if you join by line, and if the line completely resides on the same surface, then it is known as a plane. That's the definition of a plane. So plane means all equal phase points, if you join and all of them can be combined with a simple straight line type of thing, then you have a plane wave traveling through that. That means in that subplane, all the rays will have the same phase values. All the rays traveling through that plane of the waves will have same phase point values. So the information about the phase of the waves is given through the word plane wave. Okay, it has some meaning. Like person, if you are referring that he is a graduate, means he must have studied at least 15 years of education. He must have got either a BA, BCom, BE, BTech, MBBS, or some other degree like that. Some useful information you are trying to convey by saying that so and so person is a graduate. In the same sense, if you are calling a wave as a plane wave, you are indicating that the phase is same on that particular plane in the rays of any location. Okay, so this is what the additional information one has to keep in mind when we are talking of the plane waves. That is the simplest and easiest case, and hence we are always interested to know about that. Okay, and now let's come back to the case of a lossy medium. This is what is going to take priority now. Please remember, the future materials we are going to use are not the earlier ones. They are not lossless case. We are going to use good amount of lossy media. And please remember, you will be working in these cases in future. Particularly, as I told you, high dielectric constant mediums, when you are going for it, then you are also going to have some amount of loss because of the cobalt, iron, nickel atoms which are going to be introduced into the medium. Okay, so this, if you are putting it, del cross E is simply still minus j omega mu h, because we are considering these materials as diamagnetic. Okay, but still we have del cross H with this additional term which was not there. Sigma is present now. Okay, your IoT enabled devices, when you are going for it, then they are going to use silicon as the base for the transmissions. So when you use silicon, it's a semiconductor, it will have some amount of conductivity, some amount of dielectric nature. So in those cases, this is the one what you are going to use. Similarly, high frequency circuits are going to be used instead of silicon, this gas, gallium arsenide is going to be used, or gallium nitride is going to be used. For such gas devices and GaN devices, when you are going to use, this is the equation with which we will be starting. So again, taking the curl on both sides for this first equation, you are going to have del of del dot E is going to be 0. So the del square E is going to be with the j omega epsilon times del cross is coming up in this manner. Okay, this del cross H is replaced with this. So okay, so again, one equation with one unknown E and in both the terms of left hand side, and but a bit more complicated here. Okay, So this omega square mu epsilon 1 minus j times sigma by something is now put into one particular thing. Earlier we simply got omega square mu epsilon. This is what represents the propagation nature of this wave. Thereby, this omega square mu epsilon is also known as propagation constant. Okay, it represents how the propagation is happening. Now, this propagation constant becomes a complex quantity. It will have a real part and an imaginary part. The real part is known as the attenuation. Okay, how much reduction in the wave amplitude that's going to take place. And this imaginary component represents what is the change of phase as the wave propagates is indicated through this beta. It's a comma, is a peculiar type. It is a combination of two different things. That's why we put it as a complex quantity, not as a simple quantity, wherein the real part represents the change in the amplitude of the wave. The imaginary component represents the change in the phase of the wave. Okay, so this is what the one what we are going to have for this. So the real component of this you can have for alpha, the imaginary component of this you can have for beta. Is it real or complex? Definitely it is a complex quantity. We try to take the help of basics in mathematics to avoid this square root with a simplified relationship from binomial expansion and try to put this right hand side in terms of real and imaginary components. Okay, that's how we are going to solve in future. That's what we just keep it for a while. Now you can see that this equation is represented as the dou square ex to dou z square minus omega square ex. This is now taken for x component and the variation in of the del is considered only for z component. That means ex is varying along z. Okay, this is what the peculiarity what we should always accept. These are all considered as transverse waves. That means the electric field component lies in one direction but it varies in another direction. Ex is present but it varies in z component. That means like your fingers, okay, as the fingers are indicated here, okay, they are changing with length in certain other direction like this. This is having some length, this is having larger length and other things. So this is varying in this direction, okay. That's how these waves are transverse waves. That means the electric field component will be in one direction, its variation will be in another direction. Such waves are known as transverse waves. What is the other possibility? That is the longitudinal waves. The sound waves are longitudinal waves. The waves vary in pressure, not electric field, magnetic field there. In the case of acoustic waves, it is the pressure that varies and the direction of movement is also in the same. That means you will have compressions, rarefaction. Compression, rarefaction one by one. The variation is in the same direction of propagation. They are known as longitudinal waves. Whereas the ones which we are considering, the electromagnetic waves are transverse waves. It varies in one direction, it propagates in another direction. Okay, so this is one specialty what all of us must remember in this context. Okay, so here the gamma is now given in this manner. Okay, please remember this is what is very important, tan delta, right? For all lossy media, medium which gives loss for the electromagnetic waves, there is one parameter we are considering that is known as the attenuation, and here the attenuation is represented as tan delta. Delta is the skin depth or depth of penetration. These aspects we shall discuss slightly later, maybe in the next coming classes. We are going to talk about it. Just observe at this point of time. If there is any loss, this is what the additional thing what we are getting it. Earlier, we were not getting all these sort of things. Okay, so it was simply omega square mu epsilon for the value of k square, or k is given by omega root mu epsilon. Epsilon is considered it as simply a scalar quantity. Now the epsilon is no longer a simple scalar quantity. Epsilon is considered as a complex quantity. It has some real and imaginary components. The imaginary component is more crucial for us at this point of time. So this is how you are going to have. And once we find the electric field, the associated magnetic field is also observed, found by taking simply with the wave impedance. The wave impedance in this context is going to come in this manner very easily for this. Okay, just hold for that. We are going to discuss more details of waves only today. Other details we shall discuss in the coming classes. Okay, so now coming to the point of the in a good conductor. What is that the good conductor? Like all your materials we use, copper, aluminium, brass, silver, gold, all these materials we use for the electrical signal transmissions. So they are all considered as good conductor. What is that the good is? The conductivity is very, very high compared to the signal frequency and the dielectric nature of the medium. The dielectric nature is very, very poor. So the conductivity nature is very high. Conductivity is of the order of 10 power 5, 10 power 4 and all that, whereas the epsilon is very, very small. So in such cases, we try to simplify the basic expression, whatever we have got for your propagation constant gamma, and that is now considered in this manner. Okay, by simplifying this in a very useful way, we try to get it into this, and this as much distance 2 by omega mu epsilon under root is known as your skin depth, depth of penetration. So it is dependent on the incident signal frequency, the permeability of the medium and the conductivity of the medium, which is very, very high. Okay. So what is the implication of this? That means when an electromagnetic wave is incident on a good conducting media, it will not be able to enter deeper into it. That's why when you are in a very, very strong concrete building, you are not getting your mobile signals, because mobile signals from outside cannot cross the depth of the wall, which is about 4 inches, 6 inches, like that. It cannot, okay, penetrate much into the wall, and inside you will not get good amount of signals unless the signal power is very, very high. Okay. Similarly, when you are traveling in a train or a car, again, you will find that the signal strength is very, very weak because of the same reasons. Similarly, when you are traveling in a car or a train, you will be observing that the FM radio signals also become very weak unless there is an antenna which is kept outside the vehicle. Okay. That's why cars will have an antenna which is outside. That will pick up the FM radio signals more comfortably and you will be able to listen. Please remove that antenna and see what is happening. The signals will be very, very weak inside the car. So all electromagnetic waves find a lot of difficulty, and now people are trying to find out this problem, overcome to a great extent, particularly the new generation through the wall imaging systems. That means, suppose some terrorists are having some meeting and other things, and police people have come to know about it. How do they know what exactly is the arrangement inside the room? Where is the person? Okay, terrorists or some antisocials are there. How they are sitting each other? Whether there is any weapon inside? Okay, or any other unwanted objects? So how do we attack that room? So people are trying to work out very special systems which can overcome these problems, and that is what is known as the through the wall imaging. Through the wall radars are coming up at very, very high frequencies, but with lot of power. That's how even Osama bin Laden was attacked. People had this sort of a radar in their hand, and they could identify within the room where he is with his wife and other kids. How is he, where exactly, and which way if we attack him, it is very easy for us. All these things have been calculated using only these basic principles. Okay. So please remember, this equation is very, very useful for all the people who are having wireless systems in their mind. If you want to see that the wireless signal is received at the other end, what should be the power transmitted and what are the medium characteristics in between, you will be able to estimate using this particular equation, particularly inside the buildings if you have. Similarly, if you are traveling through a tunnel in a train or a bus or somewhere, you will observe that this problem is very severe and your mobile signals will be cut off without any hesitation. You will come to know that. Because within the tunnel, the signals cannot travel very easily because of this particular problem. Whatever be the signal strength outside, it's okay. But within that, this is going to give you all the hazards for that. So this equation is very, very useful for power calculations in wireless communications and wireless technologies. How much power is to be transmitted to have effective communication is decided based on this aspect. So don't try to neglect these things, or don't try to underestimate, or try to understand the physical realities of how exactly it is happening. And every wave will have a wave impedance given by this particular type of one, j omega mu by sig gamma, okay, is equal to something like this. Okay, so this we shall discuss again. Don't worry about this point. But every electromagnetic wave, when it is traveling, it will also have some associated impedance. Okay, what is that the impedance is? It is the ratio of the electric field to magnetic field quantities. The interrelationship between the electric and magnetic fields inside a wave is represented through this particular quantity called wave impedance, and it will definitely have the units of ohms. If you can work out what are the units of these quantities, j omega mu and gamma and other things, yes, it should come to ohms only. Similar to the voltage to current ratio in a transmission line. Okay, in a particular line, when you are having it, if you take at any point the voltage to ratio of voltage to current, it has to have some value. Similarly, at any point in the electromagnetic wave transmission, you see the ratio of E and H, it has to be same as this. That is the intrinsic impedance of that. That's what we say. Here we call it as wave impedance. So this particular new word, please try to remember. What if we mean by wave impedance is inside the wave, what is the ratio of electric field to magnetic field quantity? Total E to total H. That means square root of Ex square plus Ey square plus Ez square divided by square root of Hx square plus Hy square plus Hz square. That's how the total must be considered, not simply Ex and Hy and other things. Okay, so there is again some more variation in those things we'll come to know a bit later. But for today, let's try to understand total E to total H is what we call as the ratio. And this ratio is known as wave impedance. Okay, so this is what I have for today at this time. And there are many more things we are going to discuss from these aspects. This is the most important thing one has to remember for the present day, right? This is what the relationship we are going to have in the traveling waves, electromagnetic waves. When they are traveling, the electric field direction, magnetic field direction, and the direction of propagation. The direction of propagation always follow a right-handed system. E, H, and N. They follow right-handed system. Right-handedness is present. Okay, and the materials where this is going to be followed, they are known as right-handed materials. Okay, these are all naturally available materials. When you use, you will have only this sort of a wave propagation, and hence they are all known as right-handed materials. Okay, E, H, and direction of propagation, they always follow this right-handed system. Okay, E and H will be perpendicular to each other, and these two together will be again perpendicular to the direction of propagation, N. Okay, N cap. Okay, that's what we have in this slide, which has to be remembered forever. So E in this is parallel to Z axis, H is parallel to your Y axis, and N is parallel to the X axis in that direction. Okay, it is in the ground plane. You have to remember these things. Okay, so E h and y. Or you can say e is parallel to y axis, h is parallel to z axis, and x, if the direction of propagation is parallel to x axis. Like this, you can always try to rotate these ones and get the direction of propagation exactly coming up, which is following the right-handed system. So you may have a doubt, is there anything left-handed? Yes. Left-handed systems are coming up in the very, very recent last 10-15 years. People are now producing special materials, special type of materials, substances, which will give rise to a different way of propagation. They are known as left-handed materials. E, H, and the direction of propagation follow a left-handed system. So whatever problems we are finding with the right-handed materials, okay, we now introduce these new materials into the path of the electromagnetic waves and correct the problems taking the advantage of the left-handedness of these new materials. These new materials are known as metamaterials. Okay, so metamaterials are the answer for finding out solutions to the present day problems of these electromagnetic waves. So there are a lot of developments coming up in this metamaterials and left-handed nature, and all the new generation systems are going to be beneficiaries of these things. One such is your case of the cell phones. You are finding that if you use them for considerable amount of time, people get headaches because of the radiation from the cell phone falling into the brain for continuously long time, more than 20 minutes, 15 minutes like that, definitely gives rise to headaches. So how do we avoid the radiation from the cell phone going into the brains of the people? There we use metamaterials in the path of these radiations. The waves are sent through these metamaterials and they will not allow the waves to go into the brains of the people. They object in the path and return these waves towards the cell tower instead of sending them towards the minds of the people, and thereby they protect the people getting headache and other health problems. That's how metamaterials are going to be very, very useful in the next generation cell phones also, to avoid the health problems or electromagnetic hazards from the cell phones. Okay, so please try to pay attention. There are a lot many developments coming up in these areas also. This is the conventional one which you are learning, but doesn't mean that conventional is going to remain all the time. A lot many developments have come already and are coming up. And you also have a lot of chance to do research activity in this and come out with new materials and new compounds and new systems. Okay, so that's all for today. Let us try to recapitulate whatever we have discussed in the last 1.5 hour or so. We started with boundary conditions, discussed at length that why we are talking of tangential electric field and normal component of displacement density. Why not the other way? Why not the other way is because those other ones are changing across the boundary. The change is ratio, which is going to give you some ambiguity. So to avoid ambiguity of those things, we explicitly mention the components which are not changing, the components which are continuous across the boundary. And with the information of this, one can easily infer or find out what are the changes that are coming up across the boundary. That's the speciality of these boundary conditions. So we observe E tan is continuous, D normal is continuous, H tan is continuous, B normal is continuous across the lossless dielectric interface. If there is any loss, there is going to be a difference of that much loss, which is to be included in these equations. Now, then we proceeded to solve the Maxwell's equations directly, but we observed that there is good amount of difficulty of 6 equations to solve 6 components. To avoid that problem and to get one equation with one unknown, we have identified that taking one more curl operation of the basic Maxwell's equation will give us that, giving rise to del square E plus omega square mu epsilon E is equal to 0. One equation which can we use to solve any of the six components and get the solution. And the penalty is, instead of first order differential equations, we are now getting second order differential equations. But still, we have very convenient solutions in terms of sine functions and cos functions. The sine function and cos function is going to have two variables. One is in the space variable, the other one is the time variable, because the basic electric field is now a function of space as well as time. So the space variables and time variables are related to two constants. One is this, the gamma propagation constant, and the other one is omega, the radian frequency. Omega t and gamma z or gamma x is going to come into the picture. This gamma is related to omega square mu epsilon very comfortably. Gamma is simply a imaginary one if there is lossless medium. If there is any loss medium, the gamma, the propagation constant, is going to be a complex quantity, where the real part indicates the attenuation or the change in the amplitude, and the imaginary component is going to be the phase. And this E, whatever we are going to get from the solving the second order differential equation, is observed to have regular variations in space, regular variations in time. The regularity is wavelength for space thing and time period for the time variable. Okay, that regular variations when you have, then only it is called as a wave. So wave equation is coming up, and plane wave is what we are getting it. That means if you join equal phase points of different rays of these electric field, then it is going to give you a plane surface. Okay, or if you take any plane in the path of these waves, that's going to represent equal phase points. That's what the advantage we get the word plane wave. And next onwards, we are going to talk about uniform plane waves. What is that, the uniform? We shall see in the next class. Okay, thank you. Thank you for joining today. Thank you very much. The class is over.